Okay, so we are now on the air, and here are the apples from my teaser. Can you see them, Julia?
Yeah, I really like them. They're beautiful.
Yes, and they're rather smallish because they come from, you know, a tree on the Orchard House property. So these are not commercial grade apples, but I actually used to like to eat those, but I can't now.
Oh, you prefer, like, you used to like the commercial grade ones as opposed to?
No, I like these better.
They taste better. I've always thought homegrown apples, which are smaller, taste better. The commercial apples are really big, and they just have a they don't taste like anything to me. That's just the opinion I get. Like, if I eat a big red apple, I've never enjoyed store-bought apples, like, ever, because we grew so many apples, so. But I know you're not eating that right now. So why? Why are you not eating it?
Well, I found out some things about my digestion, my body, you know, which may not apply to other people, may not apply to you, for instance. You have a different situation. But for me, I found that if I just ate meat and animal products, which include eggs and cheese, and whole milk, that it is a lot better.
Okay, well, that's, if it's working for you, that's good. So you're feeling like you have more energy and you're feeling better eating that way, it sounds like to me.
Yeah, yeah, it really does make a difference for my energy. I also, for my mood, it makes me happier. So I used to brood a lot, and if somebody said something that was just a little bit off, I might think about it for a while and it might change my whole day. But when I am full of meat, that I, you know, things just kind of, it's almost like they roll off my back as if I were greased like a duck, you know?
Well, good. I mean, that's really good. If you never, like, if nothing ever gets to you, that's wonderful. I kind of wish I could be that way all the time, because there are some days that I think I'm always going to be that way. There are things sometimes I'm just like, really? But it's a different reason why.
Well, I'm sure if something horrible happened, I wouldn't be happy. But, you know, just ordinary, everyday mood is much more calm.
Yeah, I think that's an asset for sure. You know, definitely. Yeah, I definitely eat different than you. But I like the idea of this live stream, but I'll tell you why I never would have came up with it for myself.
Okay.
I get a lot of heat for how I eat all my life. I don't like it. I don't like when people comment on how I eat. Like, I like being vegan now, but when I was younger, the thing that I just hated the most was I'd be minding my own business. I'd order a veggie burger. I'm not a pushy person. I'm not telling people what to order at a restaurant. And I have just random people tell me that were my friends. Well, I couldn't give up my meat, but I'm not even that kind of person. I wasn't being there like, well, by the way, you should stop eating meat. And it just lots of unsolicited advice, opinions, and comments about why was I doing that? So that's one reason. So I'm vegan for myself, but I've never enjoyed either side of the spectrum with people who eat meat, like getting mad that I don't, or vegans that are very militant about it. I kind of just want to do my own thing, but support like vegan businesses because I believe in that. It's not that I want to be part of a social movement. It's just a way of eating and living for me.
Right. I understand. And if it works for you, I'm a libertarian, so I don't believe in telling other people what to eat.
Yeah. I got it. Yeah. So, but what I guess I'm trying to say is, I think a lot of vegans are different than me. A lot of them, even the ones that are more chill about it, I think they want everybody to be vegan. I personally don't. And a lot of people who are vegan go back to eating meat and even eating even more than before when they decide not to be vegan anymore. And it's usually the people that were really militant, by the way. Like, There's something about extreme personality types that get drawn to certain things. So I'm just doing it as a way of eating. Some people probably don't think I'm a vegan for this reason, because the very militant people have this very near idea. That's the only hesitancy I had about doing this. Like, I totally am interested in how you eat and talking about it. I just don't know what kind of reactions I would get from other people. That was my hesitation.
Well, yeah, at this point, I do feel that my eating only meat and animal products is kind of weird too. And so sometimes when I go to somebody's house or a restaurant, I feel a little bit embarrassed, you know, because we're told that we're supposed to eat anything that's offered to us. So that I can totally understand why you might feel that same way, you know, in a different direction.
I have a different idea about that, though. I am so tired of that we're supposed to, that somehow it's considered hospitable to always eat something that's offered. I think it's kind of inhospitable to just assume that somebody coming to your house would necessarily want to eat a certain thing. Like, maybe you should have a potluck, encourage everybody to bring a dish that they like, so everybody would have something that they feel comfortable eating. Like, why is it considered good hospitality and manners to always eat what's offered? But maybe I think differently. I was raised differently. Like, we always had different, even though we're mostly vegetarian and I'm vegan in my household, we all had different eating preferences. So it wasn't like one person had to eat a certain, you know what I'm saying? Like, we were open to other people having their own opinions. So not everybody thinks like me, though, I guess.
Yeah. I think that I'm always picky, and actually, that was better for me than I knew at the time. So, you know how little children will decide they like this and they don't like that, and then adults will tell you, you really have to eat all of this because it's all good for you.
But that's not always true. They found out recently, like, some of those people that, like, eat the bland diet, like, have you heard about it? They can only eat canned foods because they, like, physically have an adverse reaction where they'll throw up if somebody forces them to eat another food. Some people are just not designed physiologically to eat everything that's offered to them. So maybe there was a reason that you knew at a young age that certain foods, like, were better for you. I think people know their own bodies better than everybody else claims to know us. Do you know what I'm saying? And science kind of backs that up.
Okay, so, you know, in my history, I ate everything. We weren't vegetarian. We were not carnivores. But I especially liked meat. Whenever I got meat, that's what I liked to eat. And I liked it less cooked, and I liked it not so spicy, you know. Mm-hmm. So I basically wanted it to make sure that I was really getting the meat and not something else.
So you like, would you like sushi? Like, do you like sushi? I guess is my next question. A lot of people really love sushi.
Yeah, I do. Yeah.
Yeah, it's really popular right now. Like, I know some people, they really enjoy eating sushi. So maybe, to me, that kind of sounds like maybe how the Japanese eat in some ways, because I know they like to eat a lot of raw fish, but you like raw steak, I guess.
Actually, when I was a little girl, I grossed my mother out because I told her I liked my meat red.
That sounds like a rare steak. Yeah. I mean, I don't want to eat that, but if you're happy eating it.
Yeah, I know. But then what happened was I kind of grew up and I started to go out and eat with other people, and I accepted the food that they had. So by the time I was 30, I was eating a lot of bread, mm-hmm. Drinking a lot of Coke, you know, Coca-Cola.
Yeah, I still like Coke. I tried not to. I got back into that recently.
Yeah, it's not good for me.
It's not good for anybody, but I did miss the taste of it. So anyway, go ahead. I'm sorry.
You know what I do instead of that now?
What's that?
I brew coffee.
Mm-hmm.
And I put it in the refrigerator. Just black coffee.
Uh-huh.
And then I add water that has, you know, soda.
Oh, yeah, like the spark. Yeah, I have all that stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, so I put it together in there so it's bubbly.
Oh.
So Coke. And it tastes like Coke, except it doesn't have any sugar in it.
That's actually a good idea. That's pretty awesome. I like it.
Yeah. So anyway, I gained a lot of weight when I was about 30 just by being more accepting of other people's food.
Yeah. That can happen because you were eating a certain way and then you were eating more socially. So you were probably consuming more calories or just more food than your body wanted you to consume, I guess, for your physiological needs, right?
Right. Well, it didn't start out with more calories. That's a thing. And it's not about counting your calories at all.
Okay. No.
It was about the carb count. You know, it was high carb. And so even though I wasn't sedentary, I went walking a lot.
Uh-huh.
And I didn't understand why it happened. You know, why did I gain all that weight when I was walking more than I had before?
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't really eating more than before, just different things. So it took me about a decade to figure out that I needed to go on a low carb diet. That was still not a carnivore diet, just low carb.
So what created the change? Like recently, have you been doing some research or you just decided kind of intuitively to start a carnivore diet? I'm just curious because I've heard about doctors who do this. So I was just wondering.
Yeah, well, I wanted to feel really good.
Mm-hmm.
And I still had a certain amount of, you know, upset stomach and that kind of thing from the food that I was eating. And so I researched all of that.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things I found out is we don't need fiber.
Uh-huh.
Everybody's always said you need fiber in your diet. Otherwise, you will be constipated, your digestion won't work, et cetera. But actually, after a certain age, you know, tolerating fiber is really hard. I even read about that in Wei Xian, you know, in my book about the concentration camp.
Mm-hmm.
The elderly people there suffered so badly because they were expected to eat all sorts of really difficult vegetables that had a very high fiber content, and they were suffering terribly from that. You know, young people can do it, but as you get older, you can't.
Mm-hmm.
But also, I learned about the microbiome. So I was studying about that, and the number of microbes that you have and the kinds of microbes you have can affect your mind. In autism research,
mm-hmm.
they show that that's an issue. So what I learned from a number of sources, but one of them is Amber O'Byrne, is that we don't actually need to ferment food in our stomach if we don't eat, you know, fruits and vegetables and rice and bread and all these other, you know, vegetable-based carbs.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't eat any of those things, you don't need your microbes to be digesting your food for you.
Hmm.
And I never knew that before.
So with this new information, you just have formulated your own diet pretty much?
Well, yeah, but I didn't invent it. It's rather popular right now.
I've heard of it. I mean, I'm not doing it, but I've heard that there's a few doctors. I guess there was a doctor who was on that one show. I can't remember that commentator's name, but I know he was talking to a doctor that eats the all meat diet, I guess you would call it, or carnivore diet. So I've heard about it. It's just not something that I'm following at the moment.
Yeah, well, you might not need to.
Oh, I'm not going to. I actually feel really good eating carbs. Like, I'm kind of the opposite of you. And my mom, like, she hasn't eaten meat in 40 years. Like, so for us, we are the polar opposite of you. But I understand if this is working for you, you know. Wow. I totally get it. Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, I used to love to eat apples. Mm-hmm. And, but they are full of fiber. And they're full of sugar.
Mm-hmm.
And the sugar feeds the microbes.
Okay.
So, it, you know, I mean, they used to say you need the good bacteria, not the bad bacteria. But what if you don't need any bacteria at all if you're not trying to process sugars?
Huh. So what do you think about these probiotic diets since you're studying the microbe? Because I hear so much about the probiotic diet. Does that come into play at all in the carnivore diet? Like, is there?
Well, it's kind of like giving up on that. I mean, I used to eat a lot of yogurt.
Mm-hmm.
I used to eat a lot of pickles. I used to drink a lot of pickle juice.
I like pickles, but you don't.
Yeah. And all of that was to help. But if you are just eating meat and cheese and you don't really need that because that's not how you get your energy.
Okay. Well, I get that. Well, that's good. See that this kind of diet gives you an energy. I've never liked cheese. I liked vegan cheese when I tried it. I've always hated cheese. I don't like dairy. I don't want to eat meat. So I know this diet won't work for me, but that's great that it works for you. I'm that's good, you know?
Well, tell me about how you feel on your diet.
Well, I feel really good. I just, the only thing that bothers me is more like situationally. And honestly, like when I cook and I eat more the things that you're saying that don't make you feel good, like when I eat more salad, when I do more smoothies, I actually feel really good. Like I have a good reaction and it's not necessarily the fiber. I just like eating a lot of plant-based foods because these give me energy. Like if I drink a smoothie, I have a lot of energy. I notice when I eat more processed food and just have more social interactions, that's when I feel drained. So I'm the polar opposite of you. And I will, for ethical reasons, I will never eat meat again because I don't, personally, I don't want an animal to die from my meal. That's just my personal preference. And some people are never going to agree with that, but that's my.
It's not a problem as long as you're, you know, you're not imposing that on someone else. It's not a problem at all.
Yeah, I know. I actually feel like the meat eaters are actually kind of harder than the vegans sometimes. It's hard to say. Like, I kind of see both sides can be militant, but I've got it more from people who ate meat. So, yeah, it's always been interesting.
Well, you know, the other side of it is, you know, I think I respect fruits and vegetables a little bit more than I used to.
Mm-hmm.
And I respect that they might not be as stupid as that. You know how we use the word vegetable to label someone whose mind maybe has stopped working? I'm not sure that plants are as, you know, not alive as we sometimes assume that they are.
Well, they're definitely living vascular organisms. I mean, they have feelings, they have reactions.
Right. And I think they're actually, in some sense, you know, people like to talk about exploitation. I think that whether the plants know it and whether we know it, we've been exploited by the plants to cultivate them and plant them and fill the earth with, you know, cornfields and wheat fields and rice fields. Because as we expanded, we did that. And so we're actually filling the earth with these fields, and we're making all the other animals, you know, lose their habitat. And that's what's happening with agriculture.
It happens with agriculture. It also happens a little bit with animal agriculture, unless you're eating like animals that are raised like locally. So it can happen on both ends. The only way I see it is if we go back to having a smaller population, which I don't think most people want to do, and living more on the land, like hunting and gathering. But we can't really turn the clock back. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't think we can tell.
You know, the question is, can we do it naturally without hurting anybody? You know, I'm not saying, yeah, let's just decimate the population.
Oh, but, no. Yeah.
Yeah. But can we go back a little bit? And can we be nicer to our ranchers, nicer to the people who have grazing animals? Because a lot of the time, here's what happens with, you know, the militant side of not necessarily veganism, but saying you should eat only vegetable matter.
Yeah.
They get mad at ranchers and they don't like the amount of land that you need to graze. But, you know, to feed people based on these carbs, it would take more acreage.
Yes and no, because the animals also eat. If you look at the factory farming, animals also eat the grains and things. So.
Yeah, I'm not talking about factory
farming. Okay. I get what you're saying, yeah. That's why I don't go into this topic too much, because everybody's very they're very set in how they feel on it. Everybody has really strong opinions on this topic. I don't think anybody's going to win when it comes to this topic. I don't think people that live in modern cities are going to want to give up their lifestyle. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, I just don't foresee anybody wanting to, like, I'm not saying that they should treat those ranchers. Like, from what I heard, the way those ranchers were treated was wrong. I don't agree with that. But I don't know how we're going to turn the clock back and how people are going to agree with that at this point. That would be my only concern about that.
I don't think we can ever turn the clock back.
It
goes forward. It doesn't go back.
Yeah. So, but I get what you're saying. Like, you feel like they aren't given the rights to do whatever they were doing, which I don't know what they were doing that was hurting anyone.
They weren't hurting anyone. Yet.
And
I wasn't trying to get into the politics of that, but
yeah.
What I didn't realize before was how the plants were using us to spread themselves, specifically particular plants. So, for instance, you know, I used to go to the supermarket, and I was looking for non-GMO fruits and vegetables.
Mm-hmm.
And so I asked the greengrocer there, well, which of these apples are non-GMO? And do you know what he said?
What did he say?
He said they all are. And that's what he was instructed to say. Now, they weren't all genetically modified, but his point was they were all raised. They were all not natural. You know, they were chosen for being big.
Yeah, they have been selected. Like any apple you find at the grocery store, even if it's at Whole Foods, you're paying like, I don't know, $5 for like two apples or something. It's not going to look like an apple you would have found in the year 1800 on a tree cultivated in somebody's backyard. It's just going to be bigger. And like I told you, the local oranges, they export them to Asia now because supposedly these little oranges aren't suitable or appealing to the American market, which is just bonkers because it's a locally grown orange, but it's not good enough for us to eat. Those oranges are delicious, by the way. But these people have been forced to feel like they have to sell their orange fields now to, oh, guess what? Like to build more packing houses or factories for shipping things.
Right.
Yeah, it's kind of sad, but I guess that's progress.
Well, yeah, that's the thing. I mean, if we go back to even the biblical stories about apples, why were people told not to eat of the apple?
Because it was the forbidden fruit of knowledge of good and evil, and it was,
yeah. And when they were thrown out of the garden, they had to raise food by the sweat of their brow. But you know, even the story of Cain and Abel was about how God preferred blood sacrifice to vegetables. Uh-huh. It's really kind of funny.
It is interesting.
Yeah. So, all of the fruits and vegetables started out trying to get people to not eat them so much, and they're full of insecticide. I mean, even the natural ones.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
So when we make them more resistant to bugs of various sorts, we also make them a little bit harder on us.
Like you feel digestion-wise is what you're saying. You think it's harder to digest vegetables is because of the how they've bred them to be larger and things like that?
Yeah.
Okay.
They made them more resistant to creatures who want to eat them.
Hmm.
So that includes us.
Yeah, I understand your viewpoint. I mean, I'm not saying I like modern agriculture, but I still like to eat vegetables.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, and fruit. And I honestly, like, I don't think people are going to go for either extreme. Most people want to eat fruits, vegetables, and some meat. I think most people fall in the middle somewhere. So yeah. I don't think either end of the spectrum is going to be for anybody. Like, I don't think most people want to be an extreme raw fruitarian or just eating meat. Most people want to be somewhere in the middle.
Yeah, well, that's true. And the thing is, this is not a religion for me.
Uh-huh.
Find this out. And if it doesn't work, I can stop at any time.
Well, if you like it and it's making you feel better.
Yeah.
That's good. You know, I don't have a problem with it personally. I'm going to continue to eat the way I eat. I feel really good with it. I like supporting local businesses that are vegan. I find it funny that people wonder why so many of us buy vegan food. We have a reason for it. I know that you wouldn't get that. Like, it's not for you, but for me, it works. And I feel much better supporting those businesses. And you can buy locally grown fruits and vegetables. Like, there is a farmer's market. There are options.
Yeah.
So I just try to, like, think, well, but it's more expensive. Or you can try and grow some of your own and not eat as much meat that's cultivated. I think meat is the problem, honestly. Like, I just wouldn't eat as much cultivated meat, perhaps.
Yeah. No, I have given myself some exceptions because I really do like fruit, you know. So I give myself a hunter-gatherer exception. So if I find like a little blackberry growing on my property when I'm walking, I let myself eat that, you know, because I figure it's probably pretty harmless if I have one, you know.
I would think so. If it's growing on your own land, it's much more natural. It's not going to be as, you know, filled with chemicals and things that make it larger for the supermarket. So, but it's interesting to hear how you're eating. That's good. You know, I'm glad it's working for you. Does, like when you're eating out, like, I don't know why anybody would be bothered by that though. Like, why would they?
You know, like I would ask for a hamburger without the bun, or, and sometimes it's really hard to find water to drink because there are places where they don't have club soda. They don't have, you know, mineral water. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes in those places I do end up drinking a soda because I'm afraid to drink the water. Do you know?
Yeah, the water sometimes, yeah.
Because it might have fluoride in it.
I know, that's, I see what you're saying. There was actually another woman that was talking about that the other day. She's not going to eat exactly like you because she's a vegan, Kalel. She has a million followers. She mentioned on her channel just yesterday she doesn't want to drink fluoridated water. So a lot of people are concerned about this. Like, that spans both sides of the spectrum a lot. But it's funny, they keep telling us that fluoride's okay and everybody's okay drinking it.
No, no, we know that it's not okay, and we're going to vote on taking it out of the water in the nearby town of Houston, Missouri, very soon.
Good. I'm glad. I found out we don't, well, except the expert told us that sometimes ends up in the water anyway, but they don't seem to be purposely adding it to our local water, so I feel okay with that. Like, thank goodness. Like, why do you need it purposely added to your water?
Right. So, you know, like I went to a Chinese restaurant when I was visiting my mother, and I felt bad because I ate all the meat on the dishes and I left all the vegetables. And normally I wouldn't have done that. You know, I learned how to enjoy vegetables too at a certain age. But, you know, so I felt kind of funny about that. You know what I'm saying?
I wouldn't. Because you're the paying customer. The way I see it is, if you're paying for that dish, why would they care what you eat off it? I do know there was this one case, well, this was completely different, where this family came to a buffet every day and they would just waste so much food, like hundreds of dollars worth of food that they were piling on plates, and they got banned from the buffet. And people were like, that's so mean. But no, they were wasting, like literally wasting food. In your case, I think you were just selectively deciding you didn't want to eat a certain thing, and that's fine.
Yeah.
So if you, I mean, you don't have to eat it if you don't want to. That's, I don't care.
Exactly. And it's really funny because it's like a process of going back in time to the way I was when I was little.
You know, there, like I was telling you though, there are people, have you heard of the beige eaters, where they only could eat things that were beige, like maybe a meat, like a lunch meat that's beige, or chocolate milk, or maybe some like maybe a couple of vegetables that are really basic, like beige color. They call it the tan diet. There are some people, like if they eat anything that's not tan color, they will become physically ill. And this one woman and her son.
I don't know what would account for that, because
it's probably not that, but I'm saying there's versions of, do you see what I'm saying? Like, of people that, this one lady and her son, they both can only eat beige tan colored foods. So
that's unusual, because after all, you could dye the food and then it would be a different color. But the question is, what are the nutrients in it, right?
Yeah, I see what you're saying. I was just giving that as an example. Like,
I don't know. I have no idea. But yeah, the thing is that one of the things I learned is that, for instance, other apes have more of an extension on their stomach, that they're able to ferment things. You know how cows have several different stomachs, right?
Yeah, I know they use that as an example about like why we're more suited to one diet than the other. The only reason I get tired of hearing that, though, as somebody who has always been plant-based all my life, is that I've ate this way most of my life. So I get kind of tired of that example and the way it's used towards me. But I totally get it if it works for you. And yes, I know cows
have. We might not all be the same on the inside, because some of us may have more Neanderthal blood.
And I do. I have a lot of Neanderthal, by the way. At 23 and
okay. Yeah. So I don't know, but I mean, we are not all necessarily the same on the inside just because we're all human, you know, and so we might have completely different needs. And so right now I'm feeding these apples to Bo, but I'm not having them myself because I think he can digest them better than I can.
Yeah, maybe he enjoys. And do you think Bo would ever want to be on a carnivore diet? I know that's
no, I don't think so. I mean, I do feed him meat, but it's really obvious that I love meat.
Yeah.
And he tolerates it in small doses, but not, I don't think he would want.
I would just
all carnivore, so I'm not forcing that on him.
I didn't know if he liked meat or as much as
he does like it, but it's obvious that he's seeking sugar. He's
like
a sugar-seeking person. And if you give him too much fat, he's not happy with that. And I'm a fat-seeking person. I really need a lot of fat in my diet to be happy.
But more like animal, like hummus, so no more hummus diet? Oh my God.
Well, I mean, when I was eating everything, sure, I loved hummus, but I loved tahina more. I loved tahini more than hummus because tahini had more fat in it.
Yeah, true.
So, yeah. Right now, I'm doing this because I'm just trying to avoid all plant products except for coffee. Okay, I'm not that much of a purist. Coffee is a plant based, and I let myself occasionally use, you know, a little bit ground pepper on the meat, things like that.
More like a seasoning, it sounds like.
Right, but not enough for it to be, you know, a big part of it. I don't know. I mean, I don't know whether I'm going to last. I think that probably at Thanksgiving, I'll eat everything. I'll give myself a dispensation.
Mm-hmm. That'll be like the one day of the year, I guess, that you could.
Right. But
I realized I forgot to share our link, so I had to share it on my wall right now.
Okay.
Because I got so into what we were talking about. So anyway, I'm sorry.
Yeah. It's just that I wish they had told us right from the beginning the stuff about the fiber and the stuff about the microbiome and the fact that we don't actually need these this bacteria if we're not eating carbs and we're not eating sugar and if we're not eating plants. So I simply did not know this. I can tell you something about using turmeric, as that was one thing that I tried at one point.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the spiced turmeric?
Yeah, I have turmeric. It's okay, but I don't think it's the miracle. But anyway, what were your findings?
Okay, so this is an example of how causation, you know, correlation is not necessarily causation.
Mm-hmm.
So at one point I was trying turmeric, but I also had a cold, a severe cold, mm-hmm. and I was on antibiotics.
Uh-huh.
And I thought the turmeric was really working for me because I could feel my gut relax and I was feeling a lot better. But then after I got off the antibiotics, it all went back, and it wasn't the turmeric that was helping me. So it turned out it was the antibiotics.
Oh, like it was just kind of helping for a bit, and then once you ended it, you just didn't feel better.
So basically, my microbiome was off.
Mm-hmm.
And antibiotics were killing the little creatures.
Uh-huh.
But you don't want to be on antibiotics all the time, right?
Oh, definitely not. Actually, some of the better hospitals, Louisville and the university, like even if you have some sort of dental infection, they will only give you a tiny amount. Like they very restrict the amount of antibiotics that they will prescribe because they say they don't want you to kill off the good bacteria in your body. Like they're very stringent about it.
But here's a way to kill off any bacteria that you don't want. Just don't eat sugar. Don't eat anything that causes sugar to be there.
Okay, I totally get that. I'm not sure how I want to do that because like...
No, I don't mean it. Yeah.
That's good. I get it. Like it works. Like it does work for many people. I like fruit. I don't really like processed sugar as much though, but I do like fruit.
Yeah, but they never told us, you know, they won't tell you that you can stop eating that stuff.
Do you think they've always known, like scientists, like do you believe or do you think this is newer research?
Well, the Inuit, you know, they lived on blubber.
Yes, I've heard about that. Yeah, that's true.
And they were very healthy. And the other thing they had was very healthy teeth.
Mm-hmm. I've heard about that.
And that was because no sugar.
Mm-hmm. So you feel like it would be better for people's dental health if they ate more of a carnivorous diet, perhaps?
No, I don't really think that. I mean, I think it's not necessarily for everyone. But for those people who have problems, you know.
But I mean, I can kind of see like limiting processed sugar. I feel like nobody really needs to be eating that much processed sugar. Like we probably could all eat less bread. And I was feeling better when I wasn't eating as much bread, but I have to be honest, I sort of miss bread sometimes.
I used to love bread.
Yeah.
I did. I'm not going to lie about it.
Yeah.
In Israel, I ate a lot of bread. I got bread with butter. But U.S. bread is full of sugar.
Mm-hmm.
Full sugar in it.
That's true. I like sometimes occasionally like this Earl Wheat dill rye bread. I'm trying not to eat it though, but it still tastes really good. And I just crave that.
I know. It's a question of, you know, what your pleasures are in life and what your goals are in life. And, you know, if I were at a social gathering and I thought it was important to eat like everybody else, I would do it.
I probably wouldn't, and I don't eat like everybody else. Like I was telling you yesterday, like this one guy was like, did you get the carne asada fries? And I'm like, no, because I don't eat meat. He looked at me like I was crazy. Like, and the other lady's like, she's a vegetarian. Well, I'm more like a vegan, but the way that they understand it, they just call me a vegetarian because that makes more sense to them.
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah, but he was like, what? Like, he had never heard of such a thing. Like, I was off Mars. So I really don't care. Like, personally, I've never ate, like, people at a social function. And my takeaway is if it bothers somebody, that's kind of their problem. Because I don't think you should be expected to eat what everybody else is eating. You should, like, I believe in just doing what's best for you. And nobody should expect someone at a social function to eat. Like, I feel like a potluck is a nicer, like, encourage people to bring something that they would like, you know? Just my opinion.
Well, I think among friends, you can eat whatever you like. But sometimes you're in a situation where you need to make an impression on someone. Let's say you're at a restaurant with your boss, or somebody is interviewing you.
Yeah.
Don't want to be weird.
Well, I guess, I don't know, like I've always, people I worked with, they were okay with what I ate. But maybe that's just I've had okay experiences. I don't think ordering a burger, but I guess like, I think that would be okay. But if you, I don't know. And to me, it seems fine.
Yeah. I don't know. What I'm saying is, I don't want to make a display of it. And I don't, it's not an ideology. And if tomorrow I find out that it doesn't work for me anymore, I'll stop, because it's not a religion. It's just my health.
Yeah, it's just something you're trying out. Yeah, I totally get that. So what else about the carnivore diet would you say that was interesting to kind of think about?
Well, I don't have to eat very much before I'm full.
Okay, that's good.
So, yeah, for I kind of shared what I had for lunch. I had like two burgers and some shrimp.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I didn't force myself to eat beyond when I was full. So actually, I didn't finish the second burger completely.
Mm-hmm.
And I shared that with the dog.
Okay. So you felt cheated.
Afterwards, I felt full to the point where by the time I got to dinner time, you know, and we have set meals. So mm-hmm. it's not like me going by whatever I feel like, because Bo has to eat at certain times.
Mm-hmm.
I was still not hungry.
That's okay.
I had some shrimp because I do want to eat with Bo. So yeah. I had a little bit of shrimp and I drank some water.
Mm-hmm.
And that was it. So when you're really, really full, you know, and I'm only speaking for myself.
Mm-hmm.
Not somebody else. And I'm not trying to say you should do that or anything, but when I'm really, really full, and it doesn't feel like being stuffed at all. It's not like, you know, if I went out for pizza, or if I had a pie or mm-hmm. something like that, I would feel stuffed. And I would feel like I have to go to the bathroom pretty soon. You know?
Yeah. And
not like that. I don't feel anything in my gut. I don't feel any pressure, but I feel full, so I don't feel hungry, so I don't need to snack. So I'm fine, and I'm in a good mood. That's what it does for me.
So maybe it gives you more time, too, because you're not worrying about meal prep and what you're going to eat. And I've heard about people doing that in other ways, like having a certain thing that they eat. It cuts down on time, right? Consuming
food. It does.
Yeah, if that works for you, I think that's really great. Like, I have to be honest, I'm kind of a foodie. I like food. I like the textures of food. I like the flavors of food. Like, for me, food is joy. So I don't think I could ever do that. In fact, I kind of miss cooking a bit more, and I need to force myself to do it more, because I realize when I do prepare food more, I feel a lot of happiness. Like, it's a fun activity for me.
Yeah. Well, I like cooking, and I like preparing things for Bo.
Uh-huh.
If a banana is a little overripe, I will actually fry it for Bo, and then he likes it a lot. He calls it a hot banana.
Oh, how cute.
And also, I've started to bake apples for him. Sometimes he likes that.
You know, we used to do that with the baked apples, where you could, when you core it out, you could put like nuts or like a little bit of peanut butter in the center, and then it bakes and it kind of caramelizes. That was really good in the fall time.
He likes that. So I haven't stopped cooking just because I'm doing this. And actually, when I prepare meat, so for instance, like if I have a steak, I will cut it up and I will prepare it with butter, uh-huh. you know, and a little bit of spices. So if, I haven't stopped cooking just because I'm doing that. I'm just saying it really fills me up. It really makes me satisfied. And so I don't feel like, you know, 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours later, I don't feel that I need to eat again. You know what I'm saying?
I know what you're saying. I've always gone 7 to 8 hours without eating. People think I'm crazy. I think that, like, 9, 10, and they're like, you haven't ate for 10 hours? But me, I'm always designed where I can eat a lot, but I can go a 7 to 10 hour stretch without eating. And they don't get it, but I've always been able to do that. Like, it's not that I'm not eating. I just don't need to constantly be eating a snack because I don't like that. I don't like how I feel like I have to rush if I have to eat a snack. That drives me bonkers. I do eat a lot, but I don't like to snack, if that makes sense. Like the intermittent fasting thing, I kind of like that, where you have a stretch of time between eating.
Yeah. No, I always like to have like 3 meals a day and 1 snack. But that's it. But now I just don't even feel like a snack at all.
Oh, well, that's pretty nice. That's good. Have you been sharing your experience on your food blog a little bit, like the Feast Before Us? Because I know you used to post some food-related things.
Well, I really haven't. Actually, I want to encourage you to, I know you had some recipes.
Mm-hmm.
I would love for you to share some things.
I really, really want to do that. I feel like every time I need to just do more things. I just fall behind on so many things these days that I have plans to do. But I am excited about this new webcam. It's working pretty good. Like,
yeah, it's very good.
It's very good. I can't believe I put off getting it. It's I just got it at Walmart, $42. And
oh, that's not bad.
It's not bad, and it's portable, so it twirls around. The only drawback is I wish it had a longer USB cord, but it's really nice resolution. I think the sound's pretty good. So
yeah, it's very good.
Yeah, and I like that we can maybe practice, and maybe one time I can host a live stream, so that would be exciting. Yeah. I know you've been doing so much of it, which I really am happy for that you've been doing that, though.
Yeah, let's do it. Next Friday, let's do it on your channel.
Okay.
Do you have a subject you want to talk about next Friday?
I would have to think about that because I don't know. I don't really feel like topics just hit me in the mind lately. I wish I could think of, there are things I think about, but I'm not sure how they would translate into a live stream per se. But I was going to ask, was there anything else about the carnivore diet that you wanted to share that is interesting?
Okay. Well, if you are interested in the science behind it,
uh-huh,
I would suggest that you watch a video in which Amber O'Hearn talks about it at a keto conference. I'm going to share the link for that, you know, once we're done.
Definitely. Sounds good. Yeah, I don't have much more to say about eating vegan. I don't really have, like I'm fine with how other people eat. I don't think other people that are vegan are going to agree with me, though. They're really militant towards each other. I told you about that girl, Kalel, right? Like, how they all, like, piled down on her because she ate a candy bar. Like, oh, my God. She eats a candy bar. And they're like, you're not a good vegan. I didn't know it was a religion. I thought it was just a way of eating. Like, to me, the way that you eat, how is it a religion?
Yeah. So what was in the candy bar that wasn't vegan?
Oh, she ate a candy bar that had some milk in it, like a regular Hershey's candy bar. Like, she would eat a candy bar. So they're all going to her channel now, and they're, like, leaving hate comments. And it's very strange because, to me, being vegan is just a choice on how you eat. It's not a religion. It's not anything that other people portray it to be. But now some people have turned it into this. It's very strange. It's pretty bonkers. And I'm like, how do people have enough time in their day in life to go to someone else's channel and just tear them down because they posted something that they didn't like? It's very mind-boggling. People have a lot of time to do things like that. I wish they'd come watch our channels. Well, maybe I don't. I don't know. Like, that might not be what I want. You know?
Have people actually come to your channel and said that they don't think you're vegan enough?
Not necessarily. Well, no, actually they did. There was one person once, I posted this non-dairy coffee creamer and I thought it was vegan, but I guess there's an ingredient in it that may have whey or something, you know, and he had to tell me that. And I was like, okay, sorry, then don't buy it.
Right.
I don't care. Like, I really, really don't care. Like, sometimes I eat products that may have dairy in it. I don't, like, buy eggs and I don't buy milk. But if I eat a product, like, sometimes I'll have a donut. Oh, no. I'm just as bad as Khalil in their minds. And it might have dairy in it. I don't know. I don't, like, actively buy these ingredients, but I will sometimes eat a baked good. And I don't really, like, care if it does have dairy in it. Do you see what I'm saying? So they would consider me more of a vegetarian than a vegan because it's very strict and it's a religion to these people. And I don't agree with that at all. Like, I'm primarily vegan for diet reasons, but I'm not the strict kind of person that eschews all animal products. If it's in a product like a baked good, I don't care. I really, really don't.
Yeah. No, so I just want you to know that my carnivore thing is not a religion either. There, I make exceptions. I'm going to do whatever makes me happy. If I'm not happy doing this, I'm not going to continue doing it. It just right now, it makes me feel pretty good.
I'm glad that it does. Like, I kind of noticed too. I was like, oh, you seem like very like into your projects and things like that. And I was like, that's good. Like, you seem to be very productive. So it seems to be really working well for you. I think that's a great thing. I would like more people to do what makes them happy. I know for me, and it's not even a food related topic, I don't like the idea of just meeting people on social media, like in person or like certain things like to date. And that's completely different. I will never do that again. Like, that's not a food, but you know what I'm saying? Like, do what makes you happy. It will make you feel better. Like, there's no need to eat something if you're not feeling good. So that's wonderful.
Right. Yeah. No, I agree. And I think that's my philosophy right now about everything. Work, play, socializing. If it feels good, I'm going to continue doing it. And if it starts to feel bad, I'm going to stop doing it, whatever it is.
And you know what's funny? I don't think people in society want us to do that. Like, I think everybody wants us to feel bad because, like, right now, look at the news cycle. What do they promote every single day? Like, what is the big theme? Like, is it a feel-good theme? Not that you have to be touchy-feely, but the whole tension, I think people want us to be divided, to be conquered. Like, of course we should have our own opinions and have a dialogue, but it's like they want people fighting with each other because it serves their purposes, you know? Yeah. So somebody like you doing something that feels good, working on goals that are conducive for yourself, that's probably scary to somebody who's always been told, oh, you have to do what society thinks is best. As long as you're not hurting anybody, I think it's fine. Yeah. And you're not, so I think it's a good thing, actually.
Yeah, I feel the same way about your lifestyle. And I think, there's enough room in the world for different people who feel differently and have different needs. And if we can be respectful to one another, we can still be friends.
Yeah, of course. But maybe more people need to realize that. But right now, that's just not the way the world is being portrayed. Oh my gosh, you don't think like me. You're like X, Y, and Z. But I'm just going off on a tangent. Anyway, was there anything else that you wanted to add to the live stream before we finish or anything?
No, unless we could think of a topic for next week.
I'm trying to think about, is there anything that you would like to share? Like, in the like current events in your area or anything like that, or related to your book or anything?
Well, I thought we might do like maybe book reports on books that we've read.
Oh, I like that actually. just like
something recently that you would like to share next week?
I have a couple of books that I've read, like just segments of. It was one was about the Roman Empire, which was really changed. But interesting, it was talking about how there have been forms of climate change like throughout history, and it was just it got really scientific. I didn't read the whole book, but it was just interesting because it was showing that this is not a new phenomenon, that climates do change with human, you know, actions and things of that nature. So I thought that was a pretty interesting book. It talked a little bit about the Roman Empire in Syria. I was just looking at parts of the book that I found intriguing. So that, I don't know if I would have bought that book, but just to check out and look at, it was pretty intriguing. There's a new book I'm reading that maybe I would like to share a little bit more about next week. It's a historical fiction book, so maybe next week I would share that one a little bit more.
Okay, all right. And I have a book that I read while I was away. It was given to me by my daughter. Mm-hmm. And it's a bestseller, which I would not normally have bought or read, but since I did get it, I read it, and so I would share my critique of it.
Okay, great. That would be wonderful. So I guess we should end there. So next week our topic will be, we'll do book reviews.
Right, yeah. I think I'll just review one book, and if you have one or two or whatever that you'd like to review.
Maybe I'll talk a little bit about that Roman climate change book, just the parts that I found fascinating for myself and why I liked it, and a little bit more about this historical fiction book that I've started reading that I think is very fascinating, but I'll have to read more of it because my opinion could change. Sometimes I really love a book in the beginning and then it makes a turn in a direction that I don't always care for. So I'll have to see how it goes with this book.
Okay. So we look forward to that, and it will be on your channel.
Yeah, exciting. Okay, I'm excited. So I guess have a good night, Aya.
Good night, Julia.